Good day to you all. I hope by now you got used to the afternoon sessions instead of the morning sessions. To me, it's been a great relief, I can tell you. I can get so much work done in the morning. And every now and then on Saturday, somebody would invite me for some program or some lecture, and I used to always say no to them. I used to feel bad. Now I am able to, you know, fulfill that, complete that, and come back before 2 o'clock so that I can leisurely spend this hour with all of you. Okay, let's come to the topic, that is developing self-control. You know, what happens is, whether you are aware of it or not, we tend to all the time focus on other people. Let's say you go out, you go to a meeting, a party, or wherever it is, and you come back home. And you are describing to your family members or to your best friend what happened over there. Record yourself and see, most of us, we will talk 90%, sometimes even 100% about the behavior of others who are present there. Very rare will I introspect and say, what did I do there? Was I nice to somebody? Was I bad to somebody? What was my demeanor? What was my behavior? We somehow don't seem to do that. And as I keep reminding you all, who is the most important person in your life? It is you. There's only one person with whom you are going to be spending 24/7 into 365 into, I don't know how many years and decades of life you have ahead of you. So taking that into consideration, I thought of today's topic. And then something struck me. I said, it's easy to give gyan or to lecture to people. What about putting it into practice? So I thought, let me check whether I do it myself. And I realized, no, I'm hardly doing that introspection. I'm also succumbing to the same thing, that is commenting about others. Oh, this one did this, that one did that. This one was good to me, that one was bad to me. But how was I? So you know what I did? I followed that thing of Mahatma Gandhi. There was a very nice anecdote about Gandhiji, that a mother brought a small child to Gandhiji and said, Bapu, this boy is eating too much sweets. It's bad for his health. I'm going on telling him that, cut it down, cut it down. He just doesn't listen to me. So then it struck me, your word is ultimate to this child, Bapu, to all of us, in fact. If you tell the child, cut down on sweets, he will immediately obey you, Bapu. So please, can you do that? Gandhiji is supposed to have looked at the mother and said, yes, I will definitely do that. But get him back to me after 1 month. The mother was shocked. Bapuji, 2 minutes. I'll just bring him inside. You tell him, sweet, too much sweets are bad for you. Cut down on sweets. Within half a minute, it will be over and he'll go. Bapuji said, no. Bring him after a month. Anyway, the mother went away. After a month, she came with the child. And Bapuji called. The child, made him sit on his lap and asked him a few nice questions, made him comfortable. And then he said, you know, beta, eating too much sweets is bad. It can affect your health. You want to grow up and become a strong man. You want to do a lot of things, isn't it? So sweets do hamper your health and this and that. Why don't you cut down on sweets? The child immediately said, yes, Bapu, I will do that. And he ran away. The mother was quite puzzled. She said, Gandhiji, for this half a minute, why did you have to take 1 month to call me back? And you know the answer, no? Gandhiji said, I also have a tendency to eat too much sweets. So what I did was, this whole month, I significantly cut down on the number of sweets that I eat. So today, with a clear conscience and with vehemence and with that effectivity, I can tell this child, cut down on eating sweets. So same thing happened to me. I said, let me introspect on a regular basis whether I am developing that self-control, whether I'm looking inward and reviewing what I do. So you know what I did in the last 1 month? Every night, before I go to sleep, I would sit down, either with a family member or even if everybody is busy, by myself. And I would ask myself, how was the day? What all did I do? Not what people did to me. People may have been very nice to me, people may have been very bad to me. That's not my review. My review is, how was I to people? You know, it's like this friend of mine, who long back I remember, people asked, how's life treating you? And he had this habit of saying, how are you treating life? That has become a mantra with me. So every night I have been practicing it. Now it has become second nature. I don't go to sleep till I do that little introspection exercise. It may take 1 minute, 2 minutes. Sometimes it takes 5-7 minutes. But I make it a point to do it. And when I do that, I have the satisfaction that I am becoming conscious of myself. And that is the first step towards developing self-control. So today what I've done is I've taken up actually two topics. One is, how do you develop that self-control and maintain that self-control? The other is, if I get addicted to something, if I am doing something on a continuous basis, which I should not do, am I doing something to de-addict myself? We talk about de-addiction only when it comes to cigarettes or alcohol or drugs or whatever it is. But many a time, de-addiction is also needed when it comes to habits which can be detrimental to yourself. And that brings me to a very important point. Very often we try to gain control over others. I want control over my children or my family members. I want control over my teammates or my subordinates. As a teacher, I want control over my students. We spend so much time doing that. How much time do we spend telling ourselves, I want control over myself? And that starts with a very simple Sanskrit quote, which says, Aham Brahmasmi, I am the center of the universe. Everything else revolves around me. I am that fulcrum around which this huge earth rotates. The fulcrum is just one point. But if the fulcrum is not at the exact position, the whole wheel can collapse, right? So that is the significance of me in this world, in this universe, whatever it is. So if I take that thing saying that the world revolves around me and I am responsible for anything that I do to others and to myself. And that brings me to that very important mantra or whatever you want to call it, saying that I will take responsibility for anything that happens in my life. If you have read this great person, Stephen Covey, he had this 90-10 principle. He used to say, 10% of what happens to you in this life, you have no control over. 90% you have control. And he says, whatever happens in life does not depend on the 10%, it depends on the 90%. And he gives an example saying, anything bad happens to you, how do you react? If I react badly, if I react negatively, the consequences are very, very bad. If I react positively, the consequences are very good. I had a wonderful narration from one of my students. She was driving a car. She used to come from a very long distance to Banjara Aarti Nagar when she was doing her DCS. She used to drive her car and come. And she used to be tired. She had other responsibilities, children, all that. So when she was coming driving, she used to be a little tired and her attention wouldn't be as perfect as a driver's attention should be. So she would come, and one day she was coming in one of the narrow roads, carefully maneuvering her way through. There was this gentleman who had parked a huge, very impressive bike, jutting out on the road, which he should not have done. It was his fault. She didn't see it very carefully, and her car just bumped the corner of that bike and the bike fell down. Two huge fellows came out of the shop. They were obviously the owners of that bike. And she said, nah, I'm in trouble. You know what she did? She could have run away. She could have sped away. Nothing would have happened to her. She could have stopped and argued with those people that it's your fault. You have parked wrongly. She didn't do that. She immediately took the vehicle to the side, jumped out of it, came and started looking at the bike and telling the owner, oh my, sir, you have such an impressive bike, such a wonderful bike. People, you know, must be really appreciating you to have hardly any of these bikes that we see. It's such a great bike. And stupid me, I have, you know, bumped into the bike and made it fall down. I'm feeling so miserable. If it was a small, you know, ordinary bike, I wouldn't have felt bad. But I'm feeling so bad that I bumped into a bike which is so special. And you also must be special, so that, you know, you own a bike like this. You must be a great biker and a great bike lover and all that. This man was taken aback. Anytime that anything happens in a traffic accident, people are all the time blaming each other, right? Here she's going on and on and on, sympathizing with him. Now, can he get angry with her? In fact, the partner, the other fellow came forward and he lifted that bike and he told her, Madam Hogi, your car is blocking the road. It's a very narrow road as it is. Somebody will come and bump into your car. Please go. Nothing has happened to the bike. Go, go, go. Happily, she came off. Now, how did that happen? That happened because she was in control of herself. Normally, what happens in a situation like this, we immediately start thinking of the other fellow. Oh, he's a bulky fellow. He will try to throw his weight around. What should I do? If he scolds me, what should I do? Shall I call the police? Shall I call somebody for help? Shall I tell him that, you know, that bike was wrongly parked? We are all the time focusing on the other person, and that is where we lose out. And that is what Stephen Covey says, the 90-10 principle. Remember that if you take that 90% into account, you have complete control over the life. And to a great extent, people around you also. So what do we do? Learn not to pass the buck, as they say. Stop blaming others. Do not think that this happened because somebody said this, because somebody did that, because of somebody mention this. Tell yourself that I will take responsibility even if somebody has provoked me. In fact, there are times when I'm compelled to tell a counselee who comes to me saying that I am a victim of domestic abuse. My so-and-so, whoever may be the person, is very bad to me. Sometimes is even violent, is very abusive, very neglectful, very cruel. I listen. I empathize. I tell the person that, yes, I understand. I'm trying to understand at least how much you must be suffering because of this, right? Yes. At the same time, after all the catharsis and this and that is over, I want you to understand, I tell the counselee, what has been your contribution to this deterioration of this relationship? Initially, the person gets very defensive. I've told you the whole story and you're asking me whether I am responsible. No, I'm only saying that there is a 90-10 principle. Even if the other person is 90% responsible for whatever is happening, you are still responsible by 10%. Some people are not convinced. They say, I've never done anything wrong. I have never raised my voice. I have never been violent. I have never fought. I have never done this. I said, yes, that is how you have contributed. You know what your 10% was? Becoming completely submissive. If from day one you are assertive instead of being submissive, things may not have gone to this extent. You would have been able to manage this. And that is what I'm saying is developing that self-control, taking responsibility for yourself. Another factor which helps us in this matter is to accept my own shortcomings. Sometimes, you know, I'm very curt with people. Sometimes I don't give attention to somebody. Sometimes I do this, sometimes I do that. If I become aware of my own shortcomings, and remember, most of your shortcomings are changeable. So if I become aware of my shortcomings, then I will take the trouble of either changing them and becoming better, or even in the worst case, becoming aware of my 10% contribution to whatever has happened. Some of us are in control. Some of us do have a lot of, you know, self-awareness and self-control. But we make one mistake. We become very proud of it. I never lose my temper, somebody tells me. I'm very cautious of such a person because the person has got anger is such a basic emotion that nobody is free of anger. Even the supermen, even the greatest of people do have anger inside them, right? So, if I say I don't lose my temper, what does it mean? It means I'm suppressing my anger. And it can come out on the wrong time, at the wrong place, with the wrong person. And that is what we need to become aware of. We need to have somebody always around us who can give us emotional support from time to time. Small positive strokes. Always have at least one such person. If you can get somebody in the family, nothing like it. For any reason you don't have anybody in the family, look outside the family. Today, undefined relationships are getting more and more and more healthier than defined relationships. So look outside. If you find one person who doesn't have too much time for you, who doesn't, you know, go around with you or whatever it is, but every now and then that person genuinely appreciates you and is willing to be there for you for that one moment. If you do that, then you have somebody to prevent you from, like how the Alcoholics Anonymous have a person, you know, a sponsor who is with you. That person is not a professional or a psychiatrist or anything. But that person is just there with you saying that I am also a person who is recovering from alcoholism. I will stand by you. So when you have that, your chances of either getting addicted to some negative habits or even getting out of the addiction, even that can be, you know, much, much better chances that you can do that. The other thing, you know, which really helps in developing self-control and all that is to sharpen and build up two of the 10 life skills which World Health Organization has taught us. And these are decision-making and problem-solving. It is a very general, skill which, as you know, World Health Organization has said that it's applicable to anybody of any age in any part of the world, but more so in gaining self-control. When I know how to take the right decisions, when I know how to solve problems, I am automatically in better control over myself. And anything that you have a habit of doing, which you do on a continuous basis, it may be a good habit, it may be a bad habit. But remember that habits can become, you know, addictions. You can start getting caught up in those habits. Prevention is better than cure. We were just discussing this morning about a person who had gone so much into spirituality that everything else had become redundant to him. Family didn't matter, work didn't matter, money didn't matter. But that became such an addiction that he started doing things which were unbelievable. Finally, a psychiatrist diagnosed him eventually as suffering from schizophrenia. If he had nipped it in the bud, if he said that, yes, I want to be spiritual, I want to be religious, but I have other commitments also. I have to look after family, I have to look after society, I need to have my entertainment. If a person does that, no, then the chances of his becoming an addict are much, much lesser. And if by chance you find that you are heading towards addiction, at the earliest, try to get out of it. Now, this session, I'm not going to spend time on how you get out of addiction. We can have a separate session for that. But one thing that I can tell you is, have alternate activities. Bring variety into your life. The more variety you have, the less you will be obsessed with one thing. And when we talk about variety, also learn to swim against the tide. Have the courage to say, I will think and I will behave the way my conscience dictates. I will refuse to be part of the herd mentality. I will have a thinking of my own. If I can do that, it will be wonderful. And that brings me to one of perhaps the most important issue of today, and that is addiction to technology, screen time. Please check on a regular basis, not just one or time, how much are you spending your day on the screen, or even with your earpods. That is one of the greatest epidemics that is hitting mankind, which is leading to loneliness. The more we are stuck to the screens, the less we are emoting with people around us. We have shrunk this whole giant world down to 6 inches of the smartphone or 16 inches of your laptop. When the whole world has been gifted to you on a platter. On the one side, I see, when I start off a new batch, which recently we did last month, I give questionnaire to our students. And one of the questions that I ask is, if you had no constraints, no financial constraint, no time constraints, no family responsibility, no job constraints, what would you like to do? You will be amazed at the number of people who say, I want to go on a world tour. Such a vast world, and you want to tour the entire world. But in reality, do you keep away your screen and go on a locality tour? Do you go on a roadside tour to see what is happening on my road and stuff like that? If I can't do that, why am I dreaming of this thing called a world tour? And these are the small things which we need to look into. Of course, one of the very good tools that really helps in getting more control over yourself, which we are all aware of, many of you I'm sure are practicing, but for those who are not really, who are just aware but who are not practicing it, is what we refer to as, in different names, meditation, mindfulness, deep breathing, slowing your mind down, going into a fantasy thought world. That is something which really slows you down. And that brings us to a wonderful quote, which always impresses me. Be not so busy that you don't have time to stop and smell the flowers. Ask yourself, when was the last time that you saw a beautiful flower and you went close and you smelt it, got the aroma of it, and then moved on? How long did it take you? 30 seconds, 60 seconds? But how often have you told yourself, no, I'm in a hurry. I can't do that. I have to rush. If you find yourself doing that, there is something wrong with you. Anyway, as I told you, we've been having this discussion since quite some time among our core team and all that. So I just invited Purni to come and share one or two real life incidents of, you know, how a person can gain control and how a person loses control over oneself. Okay, so here is Purnima for you.
Mm-hmm. Good afternoon. Hope you all have had a nice lunch and also taking out time to come down, start your the phone or the laptop and listen to this, which shows your keen interest in people, in reaching out. Yay to that. And yes, we were just discussing that we should just share a few cases also. What happens is at the center, because counseling is free at the center, you all know it, right? So we have this opportunity of meeting so many different people. Yes, Sridevi ma'am, thank you ma'am, good afternoon. So, and thanks, Jayashri, hi. And we were just talking about this one particular lady who had come down. This was a long time back, quite a few years back. And while we were I was talking to her, she was mentioning to me that there was some marital discord which she was having, and also that she was a teacher in a school. So because of the marriage, there were some inconveniences that she was facing in her personal life, and the discord was affecting her. So when during the course of the chat, I was asking her that so how do you manage? So she was saying, I do get angry also, I feel hurt also. So while that conversation was going on, I wanted to check what was the impact of her anger on her professional life. She's a teacher, right? And she mentioned that, ma'am, I know one thing, that these children bestow a lot of trust on me, and I am a teacher for, so many years. Yes, I know I'm having some little ups and downs in my marital life, but under no circumstances, my own children, she had two kids, and my children in school should ever face the brunt of the emotional turmoil which I'm facing. That was such an awakening, because she came out to be such a responsible person, isn't it? She had her priorities so clear. She knew that this one area, which was her marriage, had to be addressed, but the impact of that cannot go on to anyone else, and surely so children. So that was so much of an eye-opener. And
absolutely, I agree with you. And this is a classic example. I know of people who blame. What can I do if my family members are like this, my in-laws are like that, my this thing? That is what affects my work. That is why I get upset. But if she has taken the responsibility to see that I do not, allow my personal tensions and my personal stresses to affect my students. In fact, she was telling us that she has made it a habit of reaching 15 minutes early to school so that she can de-stress. She will walk around in the garden, she'll talk to the sweeper, she'll, wave out to the children who are coming early. And in those 15 minutes, she ensures that all her stress that she has brought from home is over. And she starts off. There are innumerable examples like this, isn't it?
Just one more which came to my mind.
Please.
We meet so many youngsters, Ali, in our career counseling and things like that. So I met this young girl. Who generally it's assumed, it's so wrong, but then many of us assume that children will be with gadgets and things like that. This girl was so focused that she told, I want to ensure that I have my family time. So during their family time, no gadgets. She ensures that she has a couple of hours of sports, some games every day, and also the academic. So she says, I ensure that there is a perfect balance. And for such a young girl, was in class 11th to speak with so much of maturity, was so much of a delight in the learning
absolutely, for us to be
maintaining that.
So the bottom line is, most of us are aware of what is happening, but how many of us are putting it into practice on a regular basis? That is what we need to see, right? So what do we do to put it on regular basis? Purni is going to tell you while I just take my quick 1 minute break.
Yeah, again sharing with you different things that keep coming out. There are some youngsters, again, who we meet very regularly, and they end up telling that they have this habit of venting out, opening up. with, you know, their friends, because when we do the aptitude, then there is an interview which we do with these candidates. So these there is a question which also talks about managing stress. How do you, you know, handle different situations? And quite a few of them, you know, have been telling that, ma'am, what I do is that if I know that I'm doing something which is really not in line, I ensure that I open up with someone else, and I just quickly text to my friend, and then he may, you know, possibly help him and say, keep quiet up, you can't be doing such a thing, you know. So when anything like that happens, it's like, he says, it becomes like a reality check for me. And I'm talking that quite often when we look at middle-aged people, we assume that yes, they should be speaking or doing things with their experiences, with their learnings, with their wisdom. But I also wanted to speak about this sector of youngsters, you know, who have a mind of their own. They come up, they speak such wonderful things, and everything is a learning for us from whatever that they are speaking. So while the aptitude counseling happens and we speak to them and interact with them, we realize, oh my God, this young boy and this young girl is giving such pearls of wisdom to us, telling that, ma'am, gadgets will be there, no, but my friends will not be there. I can always catch up with them. Doesn't that show self-control? That shows responsibility and also liking to be with, you know, close and significant relationships, which takes them away from addiction and also into being responsible and control, manage their life well. Yeah, Ali, I think so many times we get
very
all these
true,
things,
very
you know.
True, very true. Yes.
So I was telling that, you know, how meeting different people at the academy is so much of a pleasure and a learning. It has actually
Absolutely.
Made our own life so much more beautiful.
Absolutely.
With their experiences. Yes. No?
And meeting all these people online in the chat box makes my life very, very wonderful.
So Shobha, come to office. Good afternoon.
Yes. I had made a small, you know, points as we generally do. And I think I'm getting very old. I forgot. So Anisa just reminded me. Can we just have a look at it? That will be the last point, and then we'll move on to your questions. This is about self-control, as I told you. How do we go about it? What are the effective strategies for improving self-control? This is not mine. I have picked it up from somewhere, but I found it to be quite, you know, true and quite effective also. Exercise, you'll be amazed how physical exercise helps you to gain control over your mind. Reading habit, it's getting to be extinct almost, but reading brings better self-control onto your self. All these little things, you know, which you can do, which improves your willpower, as it says here, practice using self-control to improve your willpower. Many people succumb to that, you know, willpower. And then, as you can see in the slide, you get temptation. The moment your willpower goes down, the temptation comes in, the distraction comes in. How many students I know who keep saying that I want to study, I know I should get good marks, but then I get distracted. Now, what is this distraction? Distraction cannot control you if you are in control over yourself. And plan for situations that might break your resolve. I know that this friend will call up. I know that I have this, which is going to be a distraction. Resolve it first before you get down to the task that you are doing for which you need your, you know, full attention and full focus and going about you know, things. Even it mentions here pay bills, but actually in reality what pay bills means is get rid of anything which is of tension. Oh, I have to pay this bill, I have to do this and that. These are the type of things, you know, which help you, which sort of distract you, and then you start losing control over yourself. In fact, long back, if you remember, I had done a this thing on time management. I've always said that time management is nothing but time prioritization. when you give priority to something, automatically you get time for it. Automatically you have the motivation, and automatically you succeed in actually carrying it out. Whether you succeed in terms of results or not is secondary, but you actually implement it. Always remember that when you implement something, you will find that there are ways and means to give you the boost. It's like practicing any skill. You want to learn a game, you want to learn badminton, or you want to learn football or whatever it is. All you have to do is to set time around and start off with doing whatever has to be done. That's all that is needed. So if you are ready to do that, I would also like to add one more very, very important point, which somebody had asked me just this morning: the role of goals in gaining control over yourself. It's a debatable point that does everybody require goals? So that was the question which I have answered, and now I'm answering to all of you. That is, no, it is not 100% necessary that you have to have goals. But goals do give you a sense of discipline, a sense of direction, and they give you a target. You see a destination because you have set a goal, and therefore your implementation is better. If I'm walking on the road not knowing where the road is leading, obviously my motivation to walk will not be very high. But if I have a goal, a destination, and I know that if I walk so many miles, I will reach such and such place which is of my choice, there I have something waiting for me. My willpower goes up, my speed goes up, my tiredness comes down. That is how it works. And this also brings me to a very interesting point which we are discussing recently, that to be able to implement this thing of developing self-control, you also need to learn something which is becoming very, very rare nowadays, that is delayed gratification. You want something, you have a right to it, you deserve it, but if it is necessary, can you delay it? Just one generation back, you had to delay a lot of your gratifications. You had to wait, for example, for the mango season to come, and then only you were able to eat mangoes. You had to wait for the monsoon to come, and then you would have the rains, and then you would start plowing your fields. You had to wait for the daylight in the morning to start off activities because electricity was hardly there. So everything had a routine, everything had certain rules and regulations laid down by nature. And that was the reason why people in general were comfortable, delaying. It was part of life that I have to wait. In my early childhood days, I remember, for example, you had to go from one place to another, and if you are relying on public transport, there was no guarantee when the next bus will come. You had to wait. Sometimes the bus would come and it would be full, and the conductor would ring, ting ting, and the bus would go off. So all your waiting for that bus is gone. Now you have to wait for the next bus to come in. But did we panic? Did we get rebellious? Did we get angry? No. He said, this is how life is. You have to travel by bus because everybody can't afford a taxi or whatever it is. And buses are going to be irregular, right? So this thing called, that delayed gratification. And a lot of research has shown that this practice of delayed gratification has to start from early life. I would like those of you who are seriously interested in this to look up what they call as the marshmallow experiment. There was this great psychologist called Walter Mischel, spelled M-I-S-C-H-E-L. Dr. Walter Mischel did a very interesting experiment. I think it was in Stanford University, if I'm not mistaken. You know, the staff sometimes had small babies. So the institution had organized a creche where the small children could be left so that the parent could work and pick up the baby from the creche and take him or her home. This experiment was done in the creche. What was that experiment? It is called marshmallow. The marshmallow is a sweet which is very tempting to small children. So the small children would be left behind in the play home and the parent would go away and the caretakers would keep them occupied doing something or the other. Now Dr. Michel, what he did was he put a table in the center, he put a glass case and he put very tempting sweets, marshmallow there. And he told all those little ones, if you want, if you're getting so tempted and you can't resist the temptation, you will get only one marshmallow and that's it. You will not get more throughout the day. To the others, he said that if you wait for a fixed period of time, you will get two marshmallows. And he said, if you wait right up to afternoon, you will get three marshmallows. What do you think happened? Human behavior is so diverse. There were some children who just grabbed and said, I want it. I don't care what happened later. And of course, afterward, they would still keep cribbing and begging, but they would not get a second marshmallow. There were some who waited. I can get two or three. They waited, waited, and whatever else they are doing, their eye is going to that glass case and they are seeing those sweets, very tempting. After some time, their patience would go away and they would pick up two marshmallows and that's it. There were children who actually gained control over themselves, and we are talking about 2 year, 3 year, 4 year old children. What they did was they waited and they got three marshmallows. Okay, that happened at that time. You know what this experiment was done by Dr. Michel was? He monitored all the children who were there in that particular group for 50 years. And he observed their growth, their evolution, their changes, and their behavior. You will be amazed to know that those who were in the third category, who delayed gratification, had very clear career goals. They were very disciplined young children and adolescents. They did not get into frivolous relationships. They eventually selected their life partner, got married, and stuck to the same partner the rest of their life. They picked up a career and a good job, and they stuck to that career and job for many, many years. But as we come to the other end of the spectrum, children who would pick up only one sweet because they can't wait, these were the ones who had very erratic careers and life. They got into trouble, they were doing mischievous things, they had multiple relationships, they would keep quitting jobs. It's amazing to see how, you know, human patterns form right from very, very early age. And that is why I brought this point up. But we have some nice comments. Let me focus now on what you people have said. Sridevi says, I heard some persons writing their properties, leaving their families to some spiritual in the name of spirituality. Yes, Sridevi, this is one of the examples that do. It is excellent to be spiritual. It can be so soothing and it can be so fulfilling. But why does a spiritual person need property? Actually, the spiritual person should be the one giving away properties to you, no? Why is it that the devotees or the followers are made to give up their properties, make their families suffer? Basic logical question, isn't it? And when you do that, it is only trying to appease yourself that I am such a great person that I earned so much money and I did so much and I built up this property, but I sacrificed that property to the guru or to the ashram or to whatever it is. Now, these are some of the areas where we need to seriously introspect whether I have control over myself or am I succumbing just because I want that, you know, spiritual satisfaction, I want moksha. So if I do this, Guruji will bless me and then I will go to heaven or something like that. So this is where these cognitive distortions come in and they can play havoc with your life. Please be very cautious about it. Right. Sridevi also says, I've come across a person who is obsessed over past events without considering what happens next, and their self-control is severely compromised. Effects of positive strokes only last for a short period. Yesterday, you have, you know, hit the nail on the head by saying that the person is obsessed with the past. Anyone who lives in the past can never ever gain control over the present and the future. I know of people who keep cursing, my father did not pay a donation and get me into engineering college. That is why my career was spoiled. My parents did not select a good spouse for me and did this, this, this. That is why today I am suffering. It may be true what they are saying. But you cannot hang on to the past, keep blaming the past, be obsessed with the past because you are losing out on the present. And because of that, you will also lose out on the future, right? Okay, Shobha says, when others are talking about anything, I don't react immediately. I only keep my mind thinking about my thoughts and feelings. It's your gift for me. Thank you so much, Shobha. But I think you have really achieved something great. And if you can do that, no, what you are doing, primarily what Shobha is doing is gaining control over myself. Others are talking. Let them talk whatever they want. I will talk to myself. I will talk to my mind and convince my mind that this is what is right. This is what I want to do. Okay. Sunita is asking, genetics, does it play a role? I am not an expert on genetics, Sunita. In fact, as of today, nobody is an expert in genetics because genetics is such a young science that we do not have evidence. If I have a particular habit, whether my great-grandfather had that habit or not, we'll never come to know because he's dead and gone. We can only reflect over what people say. Yes, your grandfather was like this, your great-grandfather was like this, all these things, right? But that does not give us a clear picture. Genetic research will really produce excellent results only two generations from now because this is a first generation. Take an institute like NIMHANS. Only from, I think, 1994 or so, they started making electronic records and this and that, which are now accessible for the next generation. So the next generation we'll see, and the next generation we'll see, and then only we'll know what is the genetic element in these areas. Veena says, self-content is being most extinct, but how do one balance self-content with living full potential? Is full potential linked to productivity is issue of today? Yes, Veena, these are very, very simple things if you look at it. As Gandhiji said, there is India is not a poor country. There is enough for everybody's need, but there isn't enough for anybody's greed. Today, you see the amount of greed. Country is developing very well. Economy is developing very well. The whole world is developing very well. But the haves and the have-nots, the gap is widening. We have people who used to be millionaires, now billionaires and trillionaires, which is the wealth of, you know, millions of people put together don't have the wealth which one person has. So that is what we need to think. Hats off to the billionaires who are giving away their, you know, instead of giving it to spirituality, they are giving it for a cause. Starting from Bill Gates to so many people. Recently, I came to know that the very, very famous Bollywood music director Khayyam and his wife Jagjit Kaur, they made a fund or a corpus where 95% of their funds were given away for charitable work. And Khayyam passed away, and now Jagjit Kaur is looking after that fund, and after her, it will go into the hands of the trustees. So these are the type of people whom you should admire and emulate and think, do I need more and more and more, or can I be content? Not content to the sense that I will give up everything, I'll take up sannyas or anything like that, right? Okay, Venkatesh is back after a very long time. Welcome, Venkatesh. Hi, Ali. Please tell us about having self-control while talking. Some people, including children, simply reply without listening to understand and reply thoughtfully. When you mentioned children, no, they learn from adults. When their significant adults behave in a particular manner, children start picking it up. And yes, it is a fact that there are many of us who cannot control our tongue. The moment somebody says something, I give back. I retaliate, I react. That is one of the worst things of losing control over yourself. I think it starts with gaining control over your tongue, and then it becomes easier to gain control over your actions. So please practice, please review. Even if you're doing it 10-20% more than what you should, start pulling yourself back right now. Padmaja says, good afternoon. Thank you, Banjara, for your noble service to contribute food for thought. Yes, I think, Padmaja, that's what all of us need. We need food for our thought and for our mind, isn't it? We all contribute in different ways. Okay. Shobha says, my student X, her father is an alcohol addict. Once I went to talk to them in a friendly manner, her mother complains about her husband's bad behavior. After some time, I went to the washroom. Both of them stole some money from my pouch. And then her husband went to drink with my money. What to do, Ali? Does wife only support him? Yes, so it's so sad that there are so many, you know, great Indian women, as I call them, who are so committed to their husband. They know that this guy is doing a lot of horrible things, but still they support their husbands. And that is what I told you, know that, are you aware of your contribution? Now it's easy to label and say, this fellow is an alcoholic, so he's the bad person. His wife, who doesn't drink and who bears his negativity, is the good person. But here is a classic example which Shobha gave us just now, that the teacher has come to talk to you. She's the teacher of your own child. You should be extra nice to her. Instead of that, the moment she goes to the washroom, you steal money from her purse and the husband goes and gets drunk. So isn't that the responsibility of the wife? At least she should say, I am not going to be party to it. I'll hold on to this bag and give it to the teacher. Or I'll tell the teacher, ma'am, please take the purse into the washroom. Does she have the courage to do that? It takes a lot of courage to go against people like these. But you should start working on it right now. Yes, Veena, thanks for the thanks. The other Sridevi says, self-control can occasionally look uncool and rigid to others. Let it look, Sridevi. Let them say whatever they want. Let them say you are uncool, you are outdated, you are too rigid, you are very this thing. Let them say whatever you want. Your answer will, number one, to your conscience, and number two, to the people who are most important to you. Yes, thank you. Nice to have you back after a long time. Sridevi says, Bandar Academy, the bus, inspiration, helping hand, NGO, noble souls. All this is because of all of you. In some way, directly or indirectly, you are the ones who contribute. Even a simple thing like participating in this program, giving your comments and questions, really helps us, right? Veena has another question for me. I'm quite content and happy, but this is pulling away from being enthusiastic as I used to be before. There can be a remedy to that, Veena. Be enthusiastic about things which are not part of the rat race. Be enthusiastic to grow a garden. Be enthusiastic to take up sketching and drawing and do such lovely drawing that people appreciate you for it. Be enthusiastic to help others. Reach out with a helping hand. Be enthusiastic to gain better control over yourself. That is the difference between being content with material things like my salary, my job, my house, my car, or whatever, and being enthusiastic about other things in life. That can create the best balance that you can think of. Yes, Madhu, thanks a lot for agreeing. And this is what, as I said, takes us up. Shobha says we are waiting for your TEDx speech. Ali, please send it to us. TEDx speeches are put up directly on the internet by the people who host the event. I don't have control over that. But if it has come out, it takes a lot of time. I don't know why they, I think they send it to their central approval authority or whatever it is. Earlier also, I have addressed about 4 or 5 TEDx talks earlier. Every time it took a very long time before it was actually put up on the internet. Avina says, thank you. Thank you so much. I felt I was on a cliff meeting you today. Made the cliff as a meadow. Wow. So now you can smell the flowers. You can enjoy the lawns. You can do everything that you want. Thank all of you for being with us. Sri Devi says, thanks for stimulating insights week after week. Helps me to connect better with people. And remember, Sri Devi also helps you to connect to your own self. And Madhu says, gratitude. I feel gratitude is one of the best emotions or the best gestures that you can do to yourself. It enriches your own life. So keep on with this, and we shall meet again next Saturday at 2 o'clock. Now that has become our standard timing. So we shall be meeting next Saturday, which is, I think, the 2nd of September. And the topic, as Anis has put up for you, learning from others' mistakes. Let's all learn and keep growing and keep evolving. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you, and bye-bye.